Thanks everyone for coming. I think it's going to be a great session. I'm really excited for the later talks, and I'm going to start us off with evolving soft robots in tight spaces. So I never miss an opportunity to show this video, not only because it's incredibly interesting and fascinating, but also because it represents a real problem in our field too. The fact that this is still the gold standard more than 20 years after it was done, it means that we're really at a complexity ceiling. It's a problem that we have to kind of approach as a field. A couple swings I've taken at this problem is looking at adding complexity to these agents overall. So one of the examples is material complexity or shape complexity. Through this, we've been able to get soft robots that mimic some things we see in nature. Maybe the sea slug isn't your idea of the pinnacle of AI, but at least it's something. We did a little bit better up to a caterpillar in the next set of work, looking at also complexity and actuation, giving evolution the ability to determine how electrical signals would travel through these muscles. But still, we're far from the types of creatures, both soft creatures like this and creatures in general, in nature, in the complexity of the agents and the AI, the morphologies, the behavior, the whole package that we're evolving. So the challenge I want to talk about it is what's the next step, what else can we do to try to get complex agents? So when I think about complexity, and especially morphological complexity, I think of almost immediately of some of the work by Auerbach and Bongard, Josh Squared. Looking at the relationship between morphological complexity and task complexity. So this says that even if we have a great encoding, they use CPPMs, and a great algorithm, they use NEAT, if we have a task where we don't need complexity to arise, there's no reason for it to come out of nothing. Even in an algorithm like NEAT that complexifies by itself, that you can see the exact same thing is able to produce these really complex, interesting morphologies, but only when it's given a task that meets the challenge and complements the tool set that we give to evolution. And I think this is a real problem in the field in general, and especially with my work, that we're just looking at locomotion over flat ground, and this is as simple an environment, as simple a task as we can get. And then looking at how task and environmental complexity compare not just with morphological, but in this work also material complexity, I think is adding a data point to that story. So around the same time, I was obviously looking at the soft robot literature a lot, found this great review from Kim, Lusky, and Trimmer that talked about why and how soft robots are good. And I've hidden most of the text from you because I don't like reading during presentations, but let me give you the highlights that they said the soft materials are essential for so many of the behaviors we see in biology, but that these things help creatures navigate complex and changing environments. They're good for deformation to surfaces, for gripping, or for distributing stress, but they're not the pinnacle of what we need. They're not something that is always good. You can think of cases where maybe you're carrying a heavy load and having a skeletal structure to help distribute the load and the stress would be helpful. So they conclude that by saying that what really matters is the ecological niche, that you need an environment where being soft or being stiff is helpful, and that they specifically point to one of the niches where soft robots are particularly good and particularly well-suited, entrance through small apertures. I didn't really know what that meant when I read the paper. So to visualize it, I looked around YouTube and found this awesome example of an octopus trying to squeeze out of this box. And the light's not great, but you can see the opening is, you know, maybe an inch around, and this octopus is trying to squeeze its entire body through this opening, and is extremely successful. I think just fascinating. I can't imagine how many research hours I've wasted on YouTube. and I think that there's some things in particular that I found really fascinating about this video in particular, that if we look at the way that the octopus sticks its arms out, it puts first the joint, the thick part of the limb where it meets the body, and then kind of pulls out the rest of the limb. And I can't even mime it well because the elbow and the bones don't even let me make that motion. And this is clearly something that you have to be a soft creature to do. And then the part that's really amazing is how it pulls its beak out through, that it takes these legs once they're outside the body and pushes against the edge of the cage, trying to pull out the rest of its body, which it's somehow able to do. So these amazing things happen in nature. Do we also worry about these things in engineering? I think that we do. There's an example of pipe cleaning robots that have to squeeze through these small spaces all the time. And they do okay at it because the pipes don't have sharp edges or sharp curves, and the sizes are exactly made for the robots. That these things clean sewers and drain pipes. But if you think about cases, I'm sorry, this is especially bad, where we don't have these regular environments. These are nanobots inside a cell, and even though they're only microns thick, the idea of these robots getting stuck, not being able to fit through small openings, say in a semi-permeable membrane inside your blood vessel, would probably be a really big problem. You can think at a grander scale too, in the wreckage after an earthquake or a tsunami, trying to find people down underneath the rubble, you obviously have to be able to squeeze through tight spaces to get to the bottom and find people trapped underneath. So it's important for nature and it's important for engineering. So can we do it also in virtual creatures? We're going to use the CPPN, Compositional Pattern Producing Network, paradigm that we've been using lately. So just a very quick overview. We start with discretizing the design space that we're looking at. And for each of the voxels, we take its coordinates and input them into this network. The output of this network gives us three values. The first determines whether that voxel should be part of the robot's body or whether it can be left empty. The second output tells us if that voxel is part of the body, whether it should be a muscle that could contract or just a passive tissue cell or fat cell. And then the third output tells us if it is a muscle, which of the two groups should it belong to that are opposing muscle groups. The green or the red are in opposite synchrony with each other. And so once we've determined what that robot will look like by iterating through all the voxels, the new addition here is we're going to enclose it within a shelter. We're going to put a cage around it. And so in the review paper, they said that there are really two applications for this squeezing through. One of the main ones is in nature is shelter. So you could think of that octopus maybe squeezing into a cave to hide from predators. And so for that, we're going to look at an escape task, asking the creatures to be able to leave their shelter to go back out through that hole. And we're going to reward them for the total number of voxels that are able to get outside the perimeter of this cage. The other thing that they point to is hunting. So we're going to look at maybe an octopus that's in a hole in the ground and a fish or some prey swims by. So it has to reach out as far as it can to grab it. We're just going to maximize the furthest voxel outside the perimeter of the cage. So obviously this task becomes trivially easy if there's no squeezing involved. It's not a tight space. So the aperture that we have, the cage, has an opening of radius 5, diameter 10. And these soft robots are cubes of 11 by 11 by 11. So that may not seem like a very tight fit just from the linear distance, but since we're trying to fit a square peg through a round hole, actually the size of this area is 150% the size of the opening, which is a fairly tight squeeze. But we're to make sure that it's a tight fit, we only count in our post hoc analysis creatures that have a face spanning at least 11 by 11 in two of the dimensions. So creatures like this that only span it in one or none of the dimensions, we still let live throughout evolution in case they decide to grow bigger later on. we don't count them in any of the numbers you're going to see later on. So what do these things actually end up looking like? You see that the beginning, its flat cubic area is unable to fit through the round opening as we expected. And so then the corners are caught, but the middle is still bulging out, is still trying to push through. And eventually there's so much force that the compliance, the deformability, bulges out enough to be able to break one of these corners free. And then you also see the compliance taking form as this the front limb of this creature folds over itself, trying to push out through this tight opening. And then, just like the octopus was able to, it gets out its first front limbs, which, as you can see in their full size, is really quite a squeeze through this opening. And unfortunately, it runs out of time, and I didn't leave it time to pull out the rest. I think another great visualization is from the top here. You can see this creature spans even more than the 11 by 11 because we're looking at the diagonal length here. And you can see again on the edges it curving up and actually following the curvature of the round opening as it folds back on top of itself. And it's apparent here that the part of the robot through the opening is squeezed tight and has a much shorter width. You can especially see it with the red voxels coming. How tightly compacted they are because they're folded in on one another and squished together. And then as it escapes, you can see it returns to its original size, which is quite a bit larger than this opening. And so some of them do manage to get all the way out of the cage and to fully escape. I could really show you examples all day, but I just have one more. And I think this one's really interesting because, like I pointed out in the opening video, of the way that the octopus was able to put out the thick upper part of its limb first and then pull the rest around, this creature ends up taking the same strategy, putting what you might call the elbow, certainly the upper part of the limb, out of the cage and using all of its force to push down upon it, and then somehow still finding the space to drag and curl the rest of its limb out underneath it. This is certainly not the way I would think about trying to fit through a tight opening. And I don't think that's true of any engineering in general, but that's the way that evolution works. And that's one of the beautiful things about it. There's a real great diversity of creatures and morphologies that came out of this. And I think Jeff will recognize the potential here already. There's this nice quadruped behavior, or nice quadruped morphology. It even arches its back like the top of the cage or the top of the opening while it's actuated. You think that this is just going to run straight out and go for the fences. But of course, evolution doesn't do what you think. And it tries to get out of all four of the holes at once. It's belly flops down. So you never know what you're going to get is the moral of the story. So we've seen that these things can escape from the cage, but how much of that is due to the softness, the fact that we have this material complexity, or is it something about the shape or the task? To test this, we give it two materials, one an order of magnitude softer than the other, according to its Young's modulus. And we find that even though they have the same encoding, the same task, the softer voxels are able to get squeezed more out of the cage in the allotted time than the stiffer one is. And this isn't particularly surprising. Hopefully softer things are better at squeezing. What I find a little bit more interesting is the fact that these robots also tend to be bigger. So you can think of an incentive for size that since we're rewarding the total number of voxels out of this opening, that having more would be good. Also in the original work, we showed that having more muscles lets you move faster too. So there's another incentive for size. But if you think about specifically this task domain, and we show it in the paper, that having more voxels makes it harder to squeeze to a smaller opening, which is fairly intuitive. But what's what I wouldn't necessarily have predicted is that the softer materials are able to overcome this handicap of having more voxels in a better way than the stiffer ones are, and are able to therefore take advantage of the nice properties of being larger. We also did the reaching task, which is able to reach out 1.5 body lengths from the center of the cage, which is about a full body length outside the outer perimeter, which was a surprisingly good value, I think, in the short amount of time it was allotted. Another surprising feature that I saw come out of the data analysis is that looking at these creatures, most of them tended to be just one material, just a single color. Even though in previous works, having the opposing muscle groups working against each other was really beneficial. And at first I thought this must just be a bug in my code, but looking back through the code and through the data, it turns out that the robots that tended to do better overwhelmingly had just one material, and that we were creating variation where there were multiple material robots, but they were performing significantly worse than those that were made out of just one. And so there's a number of reasons I can think of why this might be the case, but I'm running low on time, so I'll leave that for homework. So what's coming next? One thing you may have noticed from the data is that these things weren't particularly good at squeezing all the way out of the cage. Only a few of them happened to do that, and most just got the single front limb out, as you saw in the videos. So why is this? Maybe I didn't give them soft enough materials. Maybe I didn't give them enough time to pull all the way out. Maybe it could have been any number of the parameters associated with Neat or Voxcat or any of the other parts of the algorithm. But I think that the answer comes from thinking back to that original octopus video again, that once it's able to get out its front legs, it then uses them to push back against the cage and really yank the big volume of its beak out through that little hole. And these robots don't really have a fair chance of doing that. This is an entirely open-loop controller, so it's not able to sense when its appendage gets out of the cage. And even if it did, it wouldn't be able to change its behavior to be able to pull instead of pushing out through it. So work that I'm doing now with Josh is to look at this interface between material complexity, morphological complexity, and now adding control complexity as well. And I'm very optimistic that this will help improve the results and solve some of the problems that we see happening. So I'm running low on time, but I want to leave you with a general statement, and that the point of this work isn't to try to convince you that soft robots are good at squeezing through tight spaces. I think all of you knew that coming in. What I want to say is that as a field, when we're trying to create more complex behaviors, more complex agents, whether it's squeezing through a tight space or climbing up a wall or active perception, just having the flexibility of an encoding of an algorithm, having the tools by themselves and giving these agents the opportunity to complexify themselves isn't necessarily enough. We need to think about having complex environments and creating the right incentives to get the types of complex agents we want. And especially having those incentives aligned well with the type of tool set and the type of complexity, whether it be material complexity in this case, or generally, for many of you, that's control. That's aligned with the task that we give it, the tool set and the algorithm. So let's realize that the right task in the right environment isn't always locomotion over flat ground. That we can do things that are more specific and more complex to the problems that we want to solve. I'd like to quickly thank Josh and Hod and also Ken for some great feedback and excitement during this, and all the organizations that help make this work possible. So thank you.